Hello people, hope you're having a beautiful day. Welcome to another video trying to learn you how to become a crusher of opponents. So yes, one of the last things I talked about in my previous video was how people have the tendency to overthink their ability. They see some video on the, of a pro tour, they see some pro player win with some deck, and they think, well, I really like this deck, this is how I'm going to play. They know kind of how it works because they've seen the videos, maybe they read one or two articles on it, they build a deck and change maybe up a few things, maybe not, maybe keep it, make an accept copy. It's fine, it's okay. But what I want to talk about is the what I said, like, is like they actually think, they believe that now they are like the world's best players, they're gonna go to the FNM and become number one. Now of course they probably are pretty decent players, and yeah, they just copied like one of the world's best decks, probably cost them like €500 to get all those cards together, and they're not gonna do extremely bad or anything, they're gonna do fine. And the thing is that almost everybody else there that have the ability to buy a deck like that and that do watch those videos, they're gonna do, are doing exactly the same thing, and they're at the same level, and they're just gonna fight it out. And there are gonna be some new players that don't have those decks, that didn't have seen those things, they're probably gonna win from those players. They fight between the players that have seen those videos and learned those things about those decks and bought those decks, and some of them are going to be number one, or one is going to be number one, they're going to be number two, number three, and they're going to say, well, I became number three, you know, next time I'll become number one, and they're fine with that. The whole thing is that if you look at these groups of people, what they were comprised of, they always were going to be like number one, two, or three, because they were the person putting more, having more experience than the guy who just came around, was the noob beginner trying to build his little deck for €50 and trying to get there, and just came there to see if he can have a nice evening. They were not going to be like, they're probably going to beat those guys anyway. And I mean, the thing is that they actually think that they are really good players and that they're on their way to becoming like maybe pro players, or they can go to a tournament, become really, go really high. Well, becoming number one FNM in such a way, every other week or like once in a month or something, actually is like low hanging fruit, you know. It's like none of those people really put that much time into it or put that much effort into becoming a better player. They played a few games, they listened to a few videos, they saw, like, they looked at the pro players, heard what they had to say, they read an article, knew about what card is good, etc., how to play them, fine. But why is that pro player there? Why is he like becoming top eight, you know? What's the difference between that player and other players copying their decks? The fact is that the people that do all those things, they think they get so much valuable information, and it is valuable information. Knowing that deck list is very valuable because it is a good deck. Know how to play with it is, of course, very valuable. But if you put all this value together, they think now that they're on top of the world. But that knowledge was available to other people too, and they do the same thing. And they also think now that they are like the best players in the world. But what not has happened is actually getting like tons of experience, tons of knowledge on how to play Magic, how to become a good player. That is not, you know, you would have to read a lot more articles explicitly on how to be a good player. Doesn't even has to do with the deck, doesn't have to do with the meta. It's all about becoming a good player, and that's what I'm trying to teach you, and that is what I'm saying now. It's like, sure, you can do all those things, but if you believe now that you're like a great player because you got a great deck and you have some knowledge and you listen to these great players talk about this deck, It's just like going in a Ferrari and thinking that you're like a race driver. You know, sure, you can buy the Ferrari. You have a great piece of equipment. But actually, and if you start to, you probably will drive faster than most of the cars out there, because that's just how that piece of equipment is built. And you pay the price for that, and because it has that value. You paid like 500 euros for a deck that's like superior to like most other decks out there that are like 50 euros or 100 euros or 10 euros, you know. But, and you probably aren't the worst player in the world. You probably know some, you know, you play a lot of Magic with your friends and stuff, so you know your stuff. And then you have all this information. But to become like, if you would go to like a tournament and try to become number one at a tournament, you know, you would probably go nowhere. You wouldn't go much higher than like in the middle of the group, you know. You wouldn't go to like the top eight. You couldn't get to the number one, because just only putting so much effort in it is not going to be enough to actually be good enough to play at a high enough level to beat all those other players, because you pretty much, there's a lot of randomness, you know. You have to overcome the randomness. You have to overcome maybe some other having a superior deck. You have to overcome the fact that you maybe have bad draws, where the other person is getting better cards and you are getting worse cards. Now, a lot of players say, well, oh, I just had my deck wasn't good enough. I had the bad cards, he had the great cards, his deck was better. He you know, my deck wasn't... They give all these excuses that are not them. They're not saying that I'm not a good enough player. That's always the last thing that people will say. They will never blame themselves. They never say, I wasn't good enough. And that's the problem, because it's always you that was... It's always you weren't good enough. If you go to an FNM and you thought you had a good deck, you practice, you know your deck and everything, and you didn't become number one, it's because you weren't good enough to become number one. Now, if at some point it's a couple of years ago now actually, but I was like, my deck was so, after a while my deck became better and better, I become better and better. And then there came this point where I became so good, and my deck was so good with the meta and everything, that I just start winning like continuously, not just one number one spot, but in a few months, every time I went to an FNM or anything, I either was number one or I was really high, you know. So, and a lot of number one places in a row, and all this game I was just at a level, and it only stopped because standard was rotated out. I could have just kept dominating and dominating with that deck and with my skills, if it wouldn't have been for that I needed to like adjust for a new deck, you know. And I was always a bit poor, so buying all the new cards and everything, it all takes time. And there was this really like really the new standard, I really disliked it. I think there was like the Eldrazi and stuff and all this stuff. There were these crazy like cards you can just, and I just like the way I'm playing, like with like a mono red small creatures, it just didn't seem to like really work in this new standard. And I just love working with like small creatures. I love working with like efficient mana. So my play style, the way that I love to play, wasn't gonna work. It didn't look it was gonna work, and I had other stuff to do. So, but if that standard wouldn't have rotated out, I would have just kept dominating, and maybe I would have gone to like bigger events, and who knows how well. We had like this FNM. This group is close by here, like Friday and Thursdays. But there was another group. And at one point I thought, I wasn't even at my highest point, but I was starting to do well, and thought, well, and I had like some friends that were in this other group, so I thought that let's go at this other group that was playing. And they also had like, they were in a cafe, and that is also had like very big, even more maybe than we had, a bigger group. And the first time I played there, I got third or something, you know. I never played in that meta, I never played at them, and I got really hype. And everybody was like, wow, he just comes in, he becomes number three. And these were like, I mean, they're like smart people, man. You know, like my where I live, it's a student town, there's a university, there are so many students, really smart people, and a lot of them are play. So yeah, just becoming number three even there first time was for me like, wow, that's really good. So but the thing is, like, start blaming yourself and not your deck, not your circumstances. If you start blaming yourself, not like in a way like, oh, I'll never be good enough. No, start blaming yourself like, oh, what did I do wrong? What can I do better next time? Always look for your mistakes. Look where you are doing it wrong. You know, write it down. Make notes. Think about it. You know, listen to people. Ask people like, how can I improve this deck? What did you think? What did you see when I was playing? What did you think that I did wrong? Ask your opponents. Well, where did you think that I messed up? You know, just ask them. Play with your friends and let them be critical of you. You know, allow criticism. You know, people are so low fragile, so afraid of getting criticized or even criticizing themselves. You're never going to be like a top number one at anything if you're unwilling to look at yourself in a critical manner. I love to see my mistakes. I love to see where my weaknesses, and sometimes it's very painful because there are weaknesses in my personality that I think like, wow, how am I going to change that? You know, and they're really hard to change, you know. So, for instance, it's very personal, but like administration is a weakness for me. I hate, especially when I feel like I have a hard time, like, if there's not enough money coming in, the bills are too high, and I'm like worried, like, oh, I'm gonna fix this. I just get like very, you know, I think a lot of people have this, but I have, you know, I have like a history in my youth where we had a situation where we were like, everything went wrong. And now I just go back to that and I'm like, oh no, everything's like the falling apart, which is nonsense because it is not that bad. But I don't want to look at that weakness. I'd rather ignore it. I'd rather just make sure I always have enough money in the bank. That's easy. But it will happen again in my life. It happened like with Corona the last couple of months where I didn't have money and I was like so worried, and I'd rather it be better for me to deal with my weakness. And then I'm not saying it's going to be my strength, maybe, I don't know if it's going to be my strength, but at least deal with the weakness. So let's say you have some weakness in playing. Maybe you're overconfident. Maybe you take too many risks. Maybe you don't take enough risks. Maybe you're too aggressive. Maybe you're not aggressive enough. Maybe you do things before you think. Maybe overthink things. There are all these, you have to be very critical at yourself and find a good middle ground. You know, being aggressive is really good in Magic. But if your opponent start to sees that you're just always being aggressive, he cannot take advantage of that because he knows that you're bluffing. You're attacking with all your creatures and you have nothing to back it up. You know, you don't have any like card in your hand that say, make my creatures indestructible, or give +2/+2 to a creature. You know, if you don't have any combat tricks and you're attacking in the middle and into his area with all his creatures, and he thinks, well, he's always that aggressive, you know, I'm not afraid that he might do a combat trick, I'm just going to block all his creatures and kill them all. That's what he's going to do, because he knows that you don't have, you're always a guy who always goes all in, you know. And there might be another guy who thinks that, oh, look, this guy is so afraid to lose a creature, or he's so afraid to do anything. I'll just leave one blocker up and we're going to stop 10 of his creatures because he's not going to attack me if I leave one creature up. They will see your weakness, so identify your weakness before they do, because, you know, and you actually have to, like, to become like number one, you have to do the perfect play. The perfect play is something better than maybe what you naturally think that you should do. You should not just rely on your natural instinct. You should really use your brain and think about all the positives and the cons, and you know, what's good about this move, what would be bad about this move, what could happen. It's like playing chess. You have to look at all the opportunities, all the things that can happen. Let's try again. Let's start this game, because I can talk for an hour like this. But yeah, it's easier to talk before I'm in the middle of, you know, if I'm playing cards, I need to put the cards in, you know, or I'm gonna make mistakes. Okay, goes in tapped. It's always good, try to do the tapped cards first, of course. I mean, that's a basic knowledge. Return a land. I probably do this first, and I can return that later. We got 2 mana. Nothing there to do. Okay. Yeah, it's like with 3 color deck. I'd rather go, like, for me it's a bit much as a monocolor player. You know, I have a lot of experience with monocolor, so I'm sorry if I'm not the fastest with, like, with this kind of decks. Oh, wow. It's that bad, huh? I don't know this. I want to know this card. This card can be useful. Why do I have to do this? Let's look at this. Kelsey in the Plague. I don't know this card. Vigilancy Haste. That's nice. Kelsey in the Plague gets +1/+1 for each experience counter you have. Oh, I know, I've played this before. Kelsey deals 1 damage to target creature you don't control. When that creature dies this turn, you get an experience counter. So it gets bigger and bigger. It's nice. Vigilancy Haste is nice. I don't know, what should I do? I hate it where I have to put things away. Galvany is really good. I mean, this one can give me cards, I think. As long as opponent controls more lands, you play lands from you may play lands from the top of your library. Yes, 3 lands, I have 2. I don't know, probably gonna happen. Might happen. The Devout Chaplain. Oh, I hate this. Draw a card. This is, I need my 1 removal, which is the worst, guys. So actually it's a good exercise, because you get, if you want a deck build, you have to recognize good cards from bad cards. Now this one's giving cards. Definitely not gonna get rid of this one. This one says extra target artifact or enchantment. And that other deck has really, really, really good artifacts and enchantments. This will give me extra cards or extra lands occasionally. That's probably the worst, actually. I mean, it might work now, but I don't know. Only if I have 1 on top of my library, so there's like a 30% chance that I have that. And then I can put it into play, and as soon as I do, it kind of like that stops working, because it only works if you have less as them. So, you know, although it would be interesting, but it's not the best. But again, if I play this one, I have a creature and I get extra lands. It might be better than just, maybe should get rid of a land. Because at least that creature that might give me extra lands. It's better than just playing. I think I'm going to get rid of a land. Because I had these Verge Rangers. So see, there's always a reason to do things. You know, use reason. That's the whole thing about magic. What is going to give you the best results, you know, with the cards given. So we got 2 of this, so we got 4 actually. If we do Verge. Yeah, well, let's do Verge. Hopefully there will be I couldn't have played Verge without the white, right? So okay, because the thing is, like, if I would have had white on the field, I would have played it, I would have had still 2 lands. Yeah, 3 lands. I could have maybe played a card from the top, but I can't right now. Maybe next turn. Tapped. Okay, sacrifice, getting extra lens. So lens is gonna, it's gonna be nice with lens. Okay. Ooh, I'm getting, he's not attacking, that's good. So he has 4 lens. I got 3, now we can do verge. Nice. Windscarch crack. Nice, we got a free land. Oh, there's more lands there. Maybe next turn. Am I gonna draw that? Okay. Oh yeah, I already got, and there were 3 lands in a row on the top of my deck. Are you serious? Okay. That was kind of, I like lands. I like, especially look at all the creatures I have already. I'm not worried. So we got terminate. Is there anything that we need to maybe terminate? Because like 1, 2, 3, 4. It's gonna be 4. There's gonna be a 7/2 if it attacks me, but I can block it dead, and it has first strike. So I'm good. Do we have any more of those good cards? This is creature type. It's creature chosen type. Elemental, human. Human. It would be good to have protection from humans, but I need double white for that. I can do calcium. 1 damage. Oh, it can kill like Lightning Berserker, and it can maybe even like if, and probably like it's gonna go up Steamkin, but it would be nice if I could. Let's try this one. If I have the mana, yeah. I'm not gonna do the mirrored landscape yet because I might still be getting more cards of this. Although 1, 2, 3, 4, 4. Yeah, if he gets 5, I might get a free one more free. Okay, let's just keep everything up for defense. Verge is actually doing a great job at as defense. Yeah, I was afraid Runaway is already up. Oh, this is haste, so I hate myself. Guys, did you notice the mistake I made? Kelsine has haste. So I could have like killed the Runaway Steamkin before it got the token. Before it got the upgrade. Now it's a 2/2. Now I can only kill Lightning Berserker. I could have killed both. You see, I could have done that with Steamkin, and then next turn I could have done it with like the Lightning Berserker. Okay, so he has 4 lands, I got 4 lands. Only if he controls more lands then I can play. At least I can see my top of my library, that's interesting. So yeah, that was a really stupid mistake. What I could do, I could do 1 damage to a creature and then destroy it with terminate, because if it dies I get the counter. Yep, and also I have to be careful with this because 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Oh, Fervorous already is a creature. So next turn he probably is gonna attack me. So I wanna do a terminate on Archetype of Aggression. It's gonna take away 3 points for the forge. And probably have to play a card. I should have maybe think about what other cards I was going to play except for Terminate, but I mean they're both tapped anyway. So we got 1 red and 1 black, so that could be Reckless Carnarium or whatever. So we got 1 white, red and colorless, or double white. So we can do Devout Chaplain, we can do Frontline Magic. So but I think protection from humans, well, I it's going to be less important to have protection from humans, right? Can we do maybe a protection from God? I don't think you can have like if I get rid of archetype of aggression, that's not going to be elemental. I don't know. I could get rid of elemental too. No, I'll probably do this one. So I ping him for one, put the terminate on it, get rid of it. But I have to wait, because maybe in the next turn he might put more stuff on archetype of aggression. Maybe there is another something he will do with it. So probably do it as a reaction. And but yeah, I can do Devout Chaplain. Oh, actually this can exile target artifact or enchantment. So this is an enchantment. So I'm not gonna attack yet, so I don't need front like magic. I think I'm gonna go for this one. I don't want to. I don't want the computer to tap the rectus, so I did manually. Okay, so we're not gonna attack. I mean, he has like an indestructible creature here. I mean, I could get rid of it. Actually, I could get rid of it now. Let's think about all the options. What if I would have to tap this creature, so only the 3/3 could attack. That would mean that my first strike creature could like, is he great blocker? So I don't know. Steamkin, if it would grow, I mean, I could still block it with the plague is gonna grow too. Yeah, if it just grows by one and this grows by one, I'll keep up with it. Maybe I should attack, maybe do some damage. Like I told you, like I was looking at defense, but now maybe I should look at attack, because I'm gonna have a good blocker. So I'm gonna do attack and defense at the same time. So yeah. Okay, I'm gonna kill the archetype. Don't forget, I still have, yeah, next turn. Okay, one damage. I'm not gonna kill it. Then I'm gonna destroy it. Canarium, boom, and its purpose is gone. So he's gonna become 4/4. Oh, he's tapped though. Yeah, well, it's okay if I take a little bit of damage. That's okay. You see, I didn't see that coming. It's fine, at least I'm doing some damage to him. Where's my life? I can't even see my life total. Oh no, Sarkhan. This is... I'm glad I have the Devout Chaplain, because this is a huge problem. A huge problem that can wipe out all my creatures. If he puts like a 7 power creature in play, he can do 4 damage to all my creatures, and there's nothing I can do about it. So I need to get rid of this. So I need to tap, so I'm gonna tap. I want to see my life total. 33. Okay, so yeah, I need to tap. I could tap these two, but it's better to put something into play first. Also, I can put this one into play, and I could put, oh, this is really cheap actually. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. I got 5, so I got 2 and I got 3, so I can do frontline magic and I can do a skull clamp. Actually, I have one more. Did I miscalculate? 5, 1, 2, 3. Oh, this is double. So that's 6 actually. So I could have done riders or specialist. Anyway, so who might die? Well, I'm gonna attack with Verge. So I don't know. I don't see anything happening there. The Devout Chaplain might, because Niv-Mizzet can ping it. I think I should do put Skull Clamp on Devout Chaplain. Because, oh no, he's even weaker. Oh no. Oh. Oh, it's like probably one of my best cards. What am I doing? It's really, I need to use it right now. Okay, tap to enter creatures. Like, we're gonna get rid of Sargon. Is so, at least every creature like Niv-Mizzet, if it comes to play, you can do 4 damage to any card. You can kill any card I have, and even worse, just do damage to all of them in one go. So let's tap the new guy. This one, can it do like then 1 damage and then no? So it's not gonna, I'm not gonna use this. Woo! Oh, this is so great. This is so great. I wish I had like some kind of indestructible something on Devout Champion. This is a great card. Exiled artifact or enchantment. It's like removal on a stick. That's why I love like creature decks, because if you have abilities, you just keep doing them. Like, this can keep giving cards, this can keep like killing creatures and pumping up. This can keep giving indestructible. Rites of Gavony can just keep giving protection. This can keep giving cards. These are all so great cards. Okay, so nothing more I can attack. Because I can block, but you know, I feel you have to attack when you can attack, right? Because I'm probably gonna, if I want to block, I can block too. Okay, he's gonna give hexproof. Dragon Master. Ooh, I can ping Dragon Master. This is so good. 1-3. Why is it getting minus 1? What's happening? Doesn't it have? What happened to this creature? 1-3? Wait a minute. 0+0+2. Is it a 1-1? Oh, he used mana. He used mana from this to... He probably used the mana. Like, you can get ticked pointers off and then use it for mana. Good. That's fine. Hideaway. You can play a card. Mm-hmm. This is like a removal spell. Actually good for like Niv-Mizzet maybe. Sacrifice another creature, you gain X life, draw X cards, where X is the creature's power. So I can draw cards and get life. I mean, it looks kind of bad because you're sacrificing a creature, but getting multiple cards. Like, if something has lots of, and I gain life, so if something has lots of power for some reason, maybe because there are like bonuses on top of it, this actually could be a good card. I'm just gonna go for this one. Because I'm not getting many cards, I don't have any card advantage right now going for me, so it's good to have that. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. I can kill the Dragon Master. Let's just do it. I can attack with the I can attack with all of them if I want. I can exile a target artifact or enchantment. Ooh, I can exile this artifact too. Anyway, let's get first put like, what did I say? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 7. We can play like Kudrow. Let's play Kudrow. I mean, oh, there's something here. Okay. Let's play the commander. Any creature. I can tap both of them for to get either remove mirror shield or perforous. Oh, I wish I didn't already killed the dragon, because then I could have killed Runaway Steamkin. But yeah, it happens. So Well, this one is not actually doing much right now. So, except some damage once in a while. I think I'll go do the mirror shield, because then it becomes a 1-1. And it's just good to get rid of that anyway. And then maybe next turn I can ping it with my calcine. But it's probably going to go up. But yeah. One, two, three. There's nothing to do except attack. Again, this is lifelink. Trample on lifelink. I can ping that creature. Then I don't have to worry about the Warhammer right now. He has one blue. I don't have to be afraid. He's not going to upgrade that. So it's the ping thing. Let's do it again. Ping him for one. It keeps growing, calcine. But also it's really good, like removal on the stick. It just keeps removing his creatures. So, or her creatures, whatever. Computer. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, because this is double. So I think this is card advantage. I was talking about card advantage. Actually, what was this? You may play the exiled card without playing its mana cost if you attack with three or more creatures this turn. Oh, that was the card advantage card, right? Okay, so these things are not doing much right now. Although I could get rid of one of them with the Devout Chaplain. But then I wouldn't have to. I'm missing out on three creatures attacking. And, you know, look at how much damage there is here. Maybe I should take more risk. This is like, should I go for the long play and keep building up my strength? Or am I like now playing with my food, because I can just maybe outright kill my opponent? Well, and that's not what I'm going to do, because I have like 10, 15, 18, 21. I'm not gonna kill my opponent. But this will mainly, yeah, this card will become bigger itself. This I don't need know what to protect from. But drawing cards, who doesn't want to draw cards? Humans, yes. Okay, so I could just, can I play another one? Let's see if I can play another one. Yep. Okay, so now I have two things to tap. Let's just get rid of something. This was doing me 2 damage each turn. So, and it can become a creature, indestructible, so let's get rid of it. Now let's do, I'm probably almost gonna kill the opponent. 8, well, that's pretty low. Okay, it's going good, next turn probably gonna win. So yeah, let's not play with my food. I think I'm just gonna do an all-in attack. Is there anything at risk? Well, the Devout Chaplain could be at risk. Maybe I should just put, what is this? Valdican Artificer. Should I just give myself protection from Artificers? I don't want to look for that. Just give me humans. Okay. It can actually kill this one, so can I play this one? No. Maybe should have played this one. Okay, so let's just attack all, maybe except for the chaplain. Everything, oh, the human also can die. Anyway, this is game over for my opponent anyway. I hope you enjoyed this game. And yeah, if you want to learn more about how to become a good player, and just subscribe and like my videos and do whatever you want to do. But yeah, as you see, I will take some time to explain at least one thing really well and try to give you one really good tip. And if you just watch me, like how I make decisions, how I think, you're probably gonna pick up on why I do. Hopefully you pick up on why I do certain things and what you have to look for, and you can learn from my mistakes. Also, you can learn this deck a lot better. I've made a lot of videos with this deck, so if you wanna know this deck, I mean, just watch the other videos and all the other good tips. Anyway, hope you enjoy your road to becoming number one at your FNM and destroying all your friends in Magic. See you in the next video. Lots of love. Bye bye. Have a super great day.